Okay, welcome. I'm Rob House, and it's a pleasure to introduce and our book event for The Ultimate Weapon is No Weapon, which is an exciting reconceptualization of the problem of security in the current era by Shannon, Beebe, and Mary Kaldor. They have, in combination, an extraordinary range of experience. Lieutenant Colonel Beebe is an African specialist in the U.S. military, has had a wide range of extremely interesting postings and challenges in the military. Mary Kaldor is a very well-known academic at the London School of Economics who's been involved really, even since I can remember back to the old days when I was in diplomacy with issues of war and peace, and has advised numerous institutions, including the European institutions on matters of war and peace, the author of many previous books, including the classic work, to my mind, on human security reflections on globalization and intervention in 2007. And so it's great to have you both here to talk about this extremely provocative new work. As commentators, we have Joy Mariner from Human Rights Watch and Eyal Benvenisti, who's a member of our global faculty here at NYU and is also a professor at Tel Aviv University Law School. So what I would like to do is to invite Shannon and Mary to divide. You have a way of dividing the presentation between you. So for collectively about 20, 25 minutes, and then we will hear from the commentators and then open the floor to all of you. Thanks very much.
Okay, well, I will start and then hand over to Shannon. Well, our book, as Rob just told you, is about how to address the risks and dangers of our current era, the risks and dangers really that are associated with globalization. But, you know, it's very simple to say globalization because I think what happened was the sort of risks and dangers we're concerned about, really many of them were always here, but they became visible after the end of the Cold War. Indeed, globalization became a fashionable term after the end of the Cold War because, in a sense, we had lost our way of perceiving the world as dominated by the contest between East and West. And at that time, the worst possible thing that could happen to us was a war between East and West. And so all other risks became lesser risks. And now we see them as important because they've just become visible. But of course, there are some aspects that are new. And they are associated with globalization, if by globalization we mean a much more interconnected world, a world where we're much more aware, as Rob and I were talking, of what Immanuel Kant said, that a right violated in one part of the world is felt everywhere. We do observe rights violated in different parts of the world now, so we're more aware of these. But I think there are at least two aspects of interconnectedness which are very important. One is the way in which it's eroded the autonomy of the nation state, and in many cases it's led, particularly states that were formerly authoritarian, led to weak or failing states, which really don't have the capacity to maintain law and order. And those are typically the sort of states in which new types of violence, a mixture of political and criminal violence, take place and are typically associated with situations of economic insecurity, joblessness, and so on. And the other aspect is interconnectedness, that in the cities of North America or Western Europe, most people, that there are communities who have relations, family, friends, and who they're in daily contact with, so that actually we feel those risks and dangers inside our own cities. And I think those two aspects are, in a way, the new aspects of today's risks and dangers. We see now that transnational crime, that ideologies, extremist nationalist or religious ideologies, all of them tend to cross borders and reach into our cities. And what I think we're experiencing at the moment is what we call in the book the security gap. Actually, I've been calling it that before, and it's probably in the first human security book, which is that there are all kinds of new risks, violent, sectarian conflict, terrorism, genocide, also natural disasters, famine, homelessness, pandemics. And yet our security services, which largely consist of conventional military forces, are quite unsuited to meeting those risks. And indeed, where we do use those conventional military force, as in Iraq or Afghanistan, it makes those conditions worse. In a way, in both Iraq and Afghanistan, and we talk about that a lot in the book, the inter-military intervention pushed what were already weak states into state failure. So really the question is, how do we fill that gap? And that gap is already being filled, but not by nice global public forces. It's being filled by a range of actors, private security companies, NGOs, some of them good, some of them bad, warlords, ethnic militias, you name it. And I think that's incredibly dangerous, because even if some of them are good, what it sets up is a kind of competition in insecurity that I think can be very dangerous in the long run. So our book is kind of supposed to start a discussion, a conversation about how could we do it differently. And what do we propose? Well, basically, we call for a human security approach. And what do we mean by that? I think we mean three things. First, we mean, which is common to all definitions of human security, the protection of the individual as opposed to the state, the individual and the communities in which they live. Secondly, there is a link between freedom from fear and freedom from want. This is the most contested aspect of human security, because at one end of the spectrum, there is the United Nations Development Program, UNDP, that really sees the primary source of human security as freedom from want. They see it as a development problem. And at the other end of the spectrum are the Canadians, who see human security as basically about protecting individuals from violence. It's the same as what they call responsibility to protect. And I guess our position is somewhere in the middle. I think it's very important to address the issue of how you deal with physical insecurity, how you deal with everyday violence which people experience. But at the same time, you cannot address everyday violence without also addressing sources of economic and environmental insecurity. And the third aspect of our definition is that it's about the blurring of the domestic and the international. We are used to enjoying human security in well-organized societies. If there's a disaster or crisis, we expect the police, the health services, the firefighters, and maybe also the military or the National Guard, as was the case in the oil spill, to be available and to solve the problem. What we're really saying is that human security is about extending that way of doing security to the rest of the world. And of course, at the heart of doing security domestically is the rule of law. That's where we get our rights from, and it's different from the rule of brute force. And essentially what we're saying is, what we're on the verge of is a shift in the world from having international security based on brute force to international security based on international law. And so human security could be thought of as, if you like, international law enforcement. what we propose is that, of course, human security is something that states and local administrations provide, but there should be, basically, we should transform our conventional military forces into human security. We talk about engagement brigades, into a mixture, human emergency reaction forces, if you like, a mixture of military and civilians that could contribute to global efforts to deal with humanitarian emergencies, complex operations, whatever they're called in different parts of the world. And we, I actually, because of time reasons, because I don't want to go on too long, we set out, what we say is, yes, there is a need for the military in these roles, because sometimes there are really difficult situations where you need to use force. But the military have to be used in quite different ways. And lay out a set of six principles about how military and civil forces should be used, which, because this is a law department, I'd be interested to tell you, but for time reasons, I'm not going to go through all six. But I'd just like to emphasize some of the key points. One of the key points is that the objective is to protect people rather than to defeat an enemy. That's the first point. A second point is that it's to create a secure space where legitimate political authority, be it a state or a municipality, can be established, where local politics can take place. Because in the end, it has to be a local authority that guarantees human security. It can't be done from the outside. And the most global outsiders can do is to help create that space. It has to be within the framework of international law. If you are going to use the military, they have to be authorized by the UN and in conformity with international law. It has to be a multilateral operation. And a very key point that we make in the book is that human security operations are really civilian operations. Even though you might have the military are operating in support of civilian authorities. Civilians should be in command. And this is a very important point because people talk a lot about civ-mil coordination, and it turns out to be very difficult. And I think the reason it's very difficult is because, quite rightly, many NGOs and civilian agencies feel if they're linked to the military, they'll become a target. And the key thing is that the military have to change. Their job has to be seen as protecting people, not shooting. And, or they might have to occasionally shoot in self-defense, of course, otherwise you wouldn't use the military, but their primary task is protection and law enforcement. And also, if civilians are in charge, that reinforces this point. So that's a very important point we make. As you know, there's a huge discussion going on in the Pentagon with this new interest in counterinsurgency. And people like Petraeus said, we say in the surge in Iraq and in Afghanistan, we've made a shift from counter-terror to counterinsurgency. We're no longer enemy-centric, we're now population-centric. So is human security the same as counterinsurgency? Are we saying the same thing? I mean, I certainly think the new doctrine's in the right direction, but I think there's a huge difference which matters in both strategic and tactical terms. In counterinsurgency, population security is a means to an end, and the end is defeating the insurgents. The end, in the case of Afghanistan, is defeating the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. In human security, the end is the human security, that population security is the end, and defeating an enemy may be the means to an end. And that difference makes a difference both strategically and tactically. Strategically, it makes a difference because it affects how people view you. And that's terribly important. In Afghanistan, they're told over and over again that the Americans are in Afghanistan to defeat Al-Qaeda and make Americans safe. And so they feel like pawns in a big power game. And they have to decide, do they trust the Americans or do they trust the Taliban? Whereas if it was said, we're in Afghanistan for the security of both Afghans and Americans, it would really make a difference. Of course, lots of other things would have to change too, but if you made that narrative. And it matters in tactical terms because it changes the rules of engagement. In a counterinsurgency, you're still in armed conflict under international humanitarian law. And a human security, human rights law applies even in the middle of armed conflicts. And that means you have much tighter rules of engagement, much stricter rules of collateral damage. If it was your own country, I mean, and this happened in Britain with the IRA, we could not bomb Belfast to get rid of the IRA because that would have meant killing British citizens. Well, that's how you should feel in places like Afghanistan and Iraq. There's a lot more I could say, but I want to hand over to my co-author. What I really wanted to tell you, just to finish, was perhaps to say a little bit about the story of how we came together to write the book, and then that will provide a kind of segue to Shannon. Essentially, we come from very, very different backgrounds. I was a peace activist. I was very active in the anti-nuclear movement in the 1980s. And at the same time, I was very involved in the dialogue across the East-West divide with the East European human rights movement and the opposition. And so I was campaigning to end the Cold War. And then I became a peace and human rights activist after the end of the Cold War. And I was at the same time, all the time, a scholar writing about trying to make sense of my experiences on the ground. And Shannon, of course, has been for 20 years a serving officer. He's a West Pointer. So we come from completely different ends of the spectrum. But when we started to talk to each other, we realized that we've had a very similar evolution. For both of us, the war in Bosnia was a turning point. At that time, I was the chair of an NGO called the Helsinki Citizens Assembly, which was established after the end of the Cold War, after the experience that the peace and human rights groups had together. We decided to form an NGO which would protect civil society in difficult places. And almost as soon as we were established, Václav Havel, for instance, the president of former president of Czechoslovakia and the Charter 77 hero, playwright, he was one of our founders. Almost as soon as we were established, war broke out in Yugoslavia, and we had groups all over the former Yugoslavia and all over Bosnia. And so my HCA became an implementing agency of UNHCR, the human rights, the refugee agency. And so my job was to travel all over Bosnia, talking to local groups and relaying what they were saying to the international community. And I very quickly came to the conclusion that we needed to use force to protect people from ethnic cleansing. This was quite unacceptable, and we were relaying all kinds of proposals for safe havens, for war crimes tribunals, which really emerged from local groups in Bosnia. Shannon, at the same time, was in Germany preparing the troops to be sent to Bosnia, and he was coming to the conclusion that it was quite mad if your job was to protect ethnic cleansing, were aircraft, advanced aircraft, and heavy tanks the right instruments? So he was kind of moving in the opposite direction. Then a very key moment for both of us was the Kosovo war, the NATO war over Yugoslavia. I was still chair of the HCA, and we had local groups in Kosovo. I was also a member of the Goldstone Commission to investigate the Kosovo crisis. And I wanted NATO to use force to protect the Albanians, but I came to the conclusion bombing was completely inappropriate, that using aircraft at 15,000 feet, there was no way you could protect the Albanians on the ground. On the contrary, ethnic cleansing was speeded up within the framework of the bombing, and ordinary civilians in Yugoslavia were killed. In the end, of course, the Albanians returned to Kosovo, and now we have an independent Kosovo. But what I do think is the end result is the kind of bitterness and hatred between the two communities was made, and the two countries was made much worse. Shannon was sent as army attaché to Kosovo, and he was supposed to be finding out what the Kosovars were worried about, and instead of what he expected, it was clearing unexploded ordnance, it was water, sanitation, electricity. So that made him think security meant something different. And then finally, after 2001, I started, as Rob told you, to advise Javier Solana, the High Representative for the European Union. I ran a study group on what kind of European security capabilities, what kind of security capabilities the EU should have. And we went through all these ideas and we decided to give it a name and we called it human security. That what the EU should have is not a traditional army, but a new set of military and civilian forces. And our first report was called A Human Security Doctrine for Europe. It was about how would you implement human security. And Shannon at that time was in AFRICOM being asked to find out how Africans viewed security. And he read the report and he emailed to me and that started a conversation which led to this book. I should just say before I hand over to Shannon that, you know, we discussed these ideas endlessly within the European Union and I felt very strongly we needed to get them out to an American audience and that was the real motivation for writing the book. So.
I guess I'll take it up from there, but before I start that, I have to make the disclaimer, since I am on active duty, that these are entirely my own opinions that I'll be sharing with you tonight and not representative of the Department of Defense or the Department of Army or anything like that. But as Mary said, like any good relationship in the 21st century, we met online. How that actually happened was, as Mary had discussed, was I was at the Pentagon, and I was serving as a senior Africa analyst for the Chief of Staff of the Army and had the opportunity to brief the most senior leadership in the Department of the Army, all the four stars, the three stars, on what is security in Africa. And I started off my presentation with two points. I said, first off, Africa is a continent, it's not a country. And secondly, there's a reason that it's shaped like a question mark, because we do not understand what makes security in Africa. Well, I thought by the end of this presentation that I was going to be flipping hamburgers at McDonald's, and my three-star that was directly responsible as my boss, I thought he was going to be my supervisor flipping those hamburgers. But to the Chief of Staff's credit, he challenged me to go out and actually find out what it is that makes up security from an African perspective. That is what really set me on a direct course to looking into human security, because what Africans told me, and when I say Africans, I mean chiefs of defense, Minister of Defense, other ministers, academics, NGOs. We did a sample of about, probably I think it was about 80 or 90 different samples. And the coherence was amazing. The results were this. When we ask everyone from the Chiefs of Defense, Ministers of Defense, all the way down to a few Somali taxi cab drivers in Washington, D.C., how do you view security? The answers were these. First off, they talk about it in terms of security sector reform, not the traditional kinds of security sector reform that we see, but reforming the militaries, reforming security apparatuses to more and better reflect what are the concerns of the people on the ground, point one. Point two, they discuss security in terms of poverty alleviation. These are chiefs of defense and ministers of defense. Point three, they talked a lot about the water and the sanitation, the infrastructures, health. And finally, they discussed things in terms of the climate change, in terms of natural disasters, environmental shocks, these kinds of things. Now, as a military officer, that is a tough thing to swallow. There is not a strategic narrative that explains that for the military. So one of the things that we talk about in the book, and one of my bumper stickers that I always talk about is this. If you don't take anything else away from this discussion, remember this. We can only achieve those things for which we have words. We can only achieve those things for which we have words. And right now, in our security narrative, we do not have the vocabulary, we do not have the context to discuss security in 21st century terminology. What do I mean by that? Well, we look within, and again, these are my opinions, but nonetheless, the Department of Defense military very much looks at security in terms of kinetics, 20th century mindsets. Kinetics being, we focus on planes, we focus on tanks, we focus on guns, we focus on standing security forces getting ready to invade. We focus on ground forces, we focus on air forces, we focus on naval forces. We focus on the kinetic threats that we were attuned to for the 20th century. Yet what we see in the 21st century is not kinetic-based threats. What we see are conditions-based creeping vulnerabilities. What we see, and it doesn't matter whether we're talking about South America, whether we're talking about in Africa, we see things that aren't necessarily threats per se. We see things that are creeping vulnerabilities. Now, I grew up in the South, and so anybody knows what kudzu is, that nasty vine that you let it grow and grow and grow, and it just chokes out everything until there's nothing you can do other than just, you know, take a match to it. Well, it's a lot like that. These vulnerabilities, the health issues, the water and sanitation issues, the gender inequality issues, the education issues, all of these things that we would never consider security issues, and technically they're not, they continue to intertwine. They continue to intertwine. And if you could think of each one of these as a card, just a simple playing card. And once you take these cards and you start building a house of cards, what happens when you pull one of those cards out? Well, you don't know what card it is that you necessarily pull out, but what you can guarantee is that system is going to break down. That house of cards is going to fall. What you don't know is going to entirely fall. What you don't know is going to hit the next house of cards that's standing right there. What you don't know is it going to burn on the way down? What you know is that house of cards will not stand. Yet if you look at each one of these individually, these aren't threats. So what I talk about a lot is shifting from kinetics-based security to conditions-based security. What I talk about is opening up and not discussing security in terms of hard defense, which is the last rung on the ladder as far as security goes, but opening that aperture to understand that a lot of the security concerns of the 21st century will not be driven by the departments of defense, the ministries of defense, those kinds of things, that really a lot of that subject matter expertise in the true value added of sustainable security will be found with organizations such as various NGOs, will be found with working with various partners that are non-traditional security actors. Why is that? Because security of the 20th century was very much an algebra-based type of equation. We were looking to solve for that one variable. Oh, there's the 253rd Motorized Rifle Brigade massing on the Fulda Gap. Yep, they're getting ready to invade. Whereas security in the 21st century is calculus, it's combinations, it's permutations. We're not going to be able to find that one single variable. A lot of that is because the power of information. If you look at how and what is required in a paradigm shift, why is it that we need the paradigm shift? Well, first off, at the end of the Cold War, we went from a bipolar to a multipolar world. So on one axis, we have more instability. Secondly, we've seen state economies go from state-based, state-driven economies to multinational corporations to now the globalization of economies and the unequal and uncertain globalization of economies that we don't know what those outcomes are going to be. So you see instability on that axis. And finally, and probably the one that's most overlooked, these issues in Africa, these issues in South America, it's not like they just popped up last year. They've always been there. What's the difference? 10 digits to destruction, the power of mobile technologies, the power of information, the power of individuals to now connect with other communities of despair across the globe. It doesn't even have to be within that region. How is it that you get a 20-something-year-old girl from Belgium to go to Iraq and blow herself up as a suicide bomber? Unheard of. The power of technologies. Those are the things that we have to understand. But we can only achieve those things for which we have words. And right now, our security narrative severely, severely suffers from a lack of discourse across the spectrum. So when I go to a lot of these discussions about Africa and we're not doing enough in Africa, no, we should be doing more in Africa, I'm sort of the skunk of the party that stands up and says, is it really we're not doing enough in Africa? Is it perhaps we're not doing enough together in Africa? And a lot of that is simply because we don't have that language. And that's very much what this book is about. And if it's the language that's missing, I'm talking with every one of you tonight, but I hope at least one of you will listen and take up the challenge of if it's the language that's missing, then what is absolutely, absolutely missing is the legal framework to make this work. Just like Mary said, we have to shift from the kinetics of killing to understanding the conditions and basing this on an international legal framework. That is going to be a PhD-level exercise. That's going to be some heavy, heavy lifting, because we have all sorts of entrenched bureaucracies that are very set in 20th century ways that we have to change. We have to change, because if we don't, we continue to marginalize ourselves in the eyes of those where those threats will emanate, where those challenges will emanate, where those problems will emanate. Do we wait for them to become kinetic-based threats and in the process creating more terrorists than we're killing? Or do we have to perhaps look at it in a sustainable-based model where we can say, look, let's help work towards something where we can all benefit and all get something out of it, rather than waiting until Humpty Dumpty is broken and trying to put them back together? And with that, I know that we've got more discussion, so I'll welcome any of your questions. Thank you.
Thanks. Joanne?
Sure. Thank you. I'm just going to talk about a few of the things that struck me in reading the book, and then I want to raise, I think, for the discussion with the authors, what to me was probably the fundamental challenge that makes me skeptical about some of the book's policy conclusions. But I want to start by underscoring, since I work in the field and I've been to a lot of the places discussed in the book, just the impressive empirical foundation of the book's policy recommendations. I mean, you see here the two authors, they are not just academics, they're people who've been in the field in very different roles as an activist and as a military expert. But very much, I mean, they discuss a range of conflicts: Iraq, Afghanistan, Sierra Leone, Bosnia, Kosovo, Congo, and they discuss it from a firsthand perspective. They talk about places they've been, they talk about discussions with decision makers, both military and humanitarian, and conversations with ordinary people on the ground. So, you know, the author's views are really informed by on-the-ground empirical knowledge. But, I mean, paradoxically, at least from my perspective, I also found the book to be profoundly utopian. And the way that, or the aspect of it that made me skeptical about some of its conclusions was that at one point in the book, or a couple points, I think the authors acknowledge that a key underpinning of the book's conclusions is the idea that we have to see ourselves as part of the human community, that the goal is human security, meaning security on the ground for Afghans, security on the ground for Pakistanis, security on the ground for Iraqis, and that U.S. troops there, the overriding goal, as you just mentioned, can't be just protecting U.S. troops or protecting U.S. citizens. It has to be the broader goal of human security and the security of the people where they're operating. And as the book puts it, we can't remain mired in the framework of us and them. Not just us versus them, but just, you know, us and them. And everything, the book's conclusions flow from this understanding. So my skepticism comes from, I guess, the empirical question of, do you think the U.S. public, the European public, or indeed any public is really ready to make that, what you recognize as a profound cognitive leap? And, you know, in my experience in the conflicts I've worked on, I've seen quite a lot of reason for pessimism. And I just want to give one case example, which I think is, you know, extremely saddening and yet compelling. And it's, I think, the pretty well-known case example of the U.S. government's reaction to the genocide in Rwanda. Now, clearly, there's no greater threat to human security than genocide. Genocide is mass killing. And Human Rights Watch was quite active during the genocide. We were on the phone with people in Rwanda who feared for their lives. We had very close relationships with local human rights activists, and we were gathering up information about the killings as they were occurring. And so we got a meeting with the White House. Alison DeForge, who was our expert on Rwanda, who had worked on Rwanda for 20 years and had extremely close contacts there, got a meeting in the White House with Anthony Lake, then the National Security Advisor, and other high-level Clinton administration officials. And the goal was to push the administration to take some kind of real action. So we laid out our case. We described the killings in detail. I think we, you know, presented a bulletproof case. They could not walk out of that meeting and say they didn't know what was happening. But we did not manage to extract any promises, any sign of a commitment to changing U.S. policy to take a more active approach. And so at the end of the meeting, Allison asks Anthony Lake, she said, I don't seem to be influencing you. What do I need to do? And his answer was very simple. He said, make more noise. And what he was saying was that his phone was not ringing off the hook, that the U.S. public didn't care, that we did not have a big enough constituency, or that the U.S. public simply did not care enough about the killing of, some 500,000 people in Rwanda. And I think that really is the basic problem. And, we did see a few years later the U.S. intervening in Kosovo, but as Mary acknowledges, the form that that intervention took, I think, was really unsatisfying for people who believe in a human security approach. Because again, although the U.S. was, I think motivated by CNN and the sense that this is Europe, so it wasn't some far-off place like Africa, so it was motivated enough to intervene, but not motivated enough to intervene in a way that might potentially put a single U.S. troop in danger. So the bombings were carried out from 15,000 feet. Refugee convoys were hit accidentally because at 15,000 feet you can't make the kinds of decisions that are necessary in order to protect civilian life. And the results, as you said, were a still somewhat unstable situation and not a happy example of the human security paradigm. If I can just continue, I cover counterterrorism for Human Rights Watch, and I've seen this play out quite a lot in the past 10 years, in that the media has documented, egregious abuses in Abu Ghraib and Guantanamo, and I was somewhat shocked at the lack of public response. It was covered dutifully in the media, but I don't think there was any real feeling of a groundswell of public outrage, a desire to punish the perpetrators, which is high administrations of the Bush administration. And I thought, there's a sort of telling contrast to be had if you look at the U.S. public's reaction to what I would say is a much lesser abuse, that of monitoring phone calls within the United States. But that, which was also carried out during the Bush administration in the name of the war on terror, I think got a lot more public attention and a lot more visceral public attention than what is a much more serious abuse, the torture and indeed killing of some prisoners in U.S. custody. So I guess my question for the authors is, let's assume we can't transcend us and them. Let's assume that we remain mired in, parochial national interests. Then what? And I think if that's our starting point and we don't, we're not confident that that's going to change anytime soon, then I'm concerned about the policy recommendations of collapsing humanitarian and military space. I think I see more the benefit of this in terms of bringing more, having the military engage in more humanitarian efforts. And I completely agree with your sort of looking at the F-22 as an example of what's wrong with the modern military and drone attacks and sort of the U.S. idea that we can overwhelm the world with our technology as opposed to, doing more small-scale things that have a real on-the-ground benefit. But I'm more skeptical of the idea that humanitarian organizations need to work closer with the military. And, I have to admit, I come at this as a representative of an organization that doesn't even take U.S. funding for fear of having that taint our actions or having that taint the public's perception of our actions, and particularly, publics abroad. As you recognize in your book, it has been an extremely violent decade for humanitarian actors. Humanitarian actors are killed, kidnapped, subject to violence all over the world where they work on an increasing basis. The most glaring example was the attack on UN headquarters in Iraq in August 2004, but that attack is almost become paradigmatic. So, given the realities of the world we work in today, I guess I am concerned. I mean, you seem to take the collapsing of humanitarian and military space, both as a given that it's something that's happening and there's not much we can do about it, but also as somewhat of a goal. And I would, from my perspective, still want to fight off that collapsing and try to preserve neutrality and independence of human rights and humanitarian actors.
Thanks a lot. Eyal?
Yeah, so thanks. So I think Rob invited me to talk, maybe because of my experience as a teacher on international humanitarian law. And so I will try to give the perspective from law, from international humanitarian law, maybe to help those who want to do a doctoral dissertation on this subject, give my take on this. So I think this is indeed an important book, and I think it it does begin a discussion that is morally required. And in this discussion, I think it's important to note that the human security approach has shares key affinities with the traditional IHL, with traditional laws of war, and also shares both in terms of the prescriptions and in terms of the assumptions. So I would suggest that the IHL, international humanitarian law, although it can be explained on self-interest, it does is informed, if not founded, on principles of human dignity, just like the human security approach. And with respect to the shared prescriptions, I would point out that also international humanitarian law provides, you know, the well-known principle of avoiding unnecessary killing, even of combatants. So even including in occupied territories, including in, you know, the so-called targeted killing, there is an obligation to try and find alternatives to killing. And even this is even under humanitarian law, without mentioning human rights law, where this is quite clear, an obligation to try to avoid killing even those who risk your life as much as possible. I'll go back to the 1868 St. Petersburg Declaration, maybe the first document on tries to stipulate rules of IHL, where they begin by saying that the progress of civilization should have the effect of alleviating as much as possible the calamities of war. The goal, the only legitimate object which states should is that states should endeavor to accomplish during war is to weaken the enemy forces. The purpose, for this purpose, it is sufficient to disable the greatest possible number of men, not to kill. Killing is aiming in order to kill. This is something that is a recent development, but where military targets, objective targets like weaponry or ports, being replaced by human targets. This is a recent phenomenon, but the traditional perspective, trying to eliminate as much as possible killing. Now, with respect to the civilian population, there is a key, I mean, the principle of distinction, trying to avoid as much as possible harm to civilians, there is a key difference between IHL and the human rights perspective during hostilities. So there is an obligation to avoid harm. There is no clear obligation to protect, proactively protect civilians. But this is also being, under human rights law, an obligation. So there's a positive obligation to protect individuals regardless of their national affiliation. In the occupation phase, we have the law from the 19th century strengthened by the Geneva Convention of 1949, prescribing all sorts of obligations, positive obligations that the occupier, those forces who are in charge, have to comply with, of course, including the protecting of honors, protecting of rights of individuals, ensuring that there's proper functioning of all institutions for the education, medical services, food. The occupying power should, and I quote from the Geneva Convention, should bring in the necessary foodstuffs, medical stores, and other articles if the resources of the occupied territory are inadequate, etc. So this is in terms of the prescriptions, but also in terms of the assumption. There are shared assumptions with this human security approach and IHN. And I wrote down six assumptions that are, in fact, I would suggest, I understand, necessary for the human approach to succeed. And these are the following. First of all, there's an assumption that civilian population can be separated out from combatants, that you can identify those who are civilians and those who you want to create contacts with. And then the second assumption is that this civilian population is winnable. They are uncommitted. They will have an incentive to cooperate with you, with the intervener. They will have incentive to do so for materials and benefits. And here's a point that that is made in this book, which is, I think, an important one, but the ultimate question is whether it can be discernible by the population. I mean, the author state in the book that the human security approach is more effective, has more potential, because they do not offer only material benefits. They also their approach also provide a sense of human aspect. So the idea that the intervener views the indigenous population as equal and entitled to equal concern and respect, and therefore there's more chance that they will be winnable, that they can be cooperative with the interveners. But still, this is an assumption. This is an assumption that they are uncommitted, that they are winnable. The third assumption is that the civilian population is capable of overcoming internal collective action problems, that the intervener does not waste resources for building house of cards. Something will remain when they leave. The fourth assumption is the intervener knows how to do it right. The fifth one is that the intervener is capable, and this is was already mentioned, the intervener is capable of doing so, both in terms of the resources that it has and in terms of the domestic political support that that it can generate. And the sixth assumption is that the population knows to discern good faith intervener from one with bad faith. Now, perhaps we need to distinguish between different types of conflicts. For example, I think that in inter-ethnic conflicts, it would be much more difficult to find population that is not committed, population that will believe, will trust the intervener, population who will not interpret the intervener as always siding with the other side, and population that is capable of mending relations with the other side and building common institutions. So obviously, I see the main contribution of the book, the first contribution, as is the suggestion that the use of force is often worse than futile. It is counterproductive. And that therefore decision makers should seek every alternative to the recourse to force and try to minimize as much as possible. And I think that the other benefit or importance of the book is that it provides keys on the alternatives. In the discussion that is that will ensue, hopefully, I think that the main task is to try to see how to ensure that these assumptions that the book is based on, these expectations can be actually fulfilled, and we can overcome these information asymmetries and enable the creation of conditions in which assistance could be effective. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. I wonder whether Mary and or Shannon, you'd like to respond at all at this stage to the comments, or should we just open it up?
I'm happy to do either. I certainly have things I'd like to say to both comments, but if you'd like me to do it now, I can, or I can wait for questions.
What would you prefer, Shannon?
I think it'd probably be good to stimulate the discussion through maybe answering some of this, and that could lead on to further discussion. So, Mary, if you want to take first.
Sure. Okay. Well, let me talk about both. Of course, the book is utopian. Of course it is. That was the point. And I think sometimes we need a few utopias. But having said that, you know, there are several arguments I'd like to put forward in relation to all of this. First of all, I do think that human rights sensibilities, even though you may be and I am frustrated by how limited they are just extraordinary compared with how they were 20 years ago or a century ago. You know, I often think, and I hope my Israeli friend will excuse me, but sometimes people discuss this issue that Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East, and one's response to that is, well, you know, can you be a democracy if large parts of the population are excluded? And actually, people are outraged by what's happened to Palestinians, but if you think about 1776, which we celebrate as the great moment of founding democracy, which excluded American Indians, African Americans, and women, actually, you know, and at that time it was celebrated as a democracy. If 1776 happened today, we would all be appalled. We would all be out demonstrating. And that's a kind of illustration of the degree to which, and in the last 20 years, particularly since the end of the Cold War, our concerns about these issues have enormously increased. So that's the first thing. Second point, I think notions of that you put being American, British, German, European before being a human being are actually recent notions dating from the 16th and 17th and 18th centuries. You know, before that, people were very parochial. They were concerned about their village. And obviously, it's very natural to be concerned about the people you know. That is natural. Actually, and one of the reasons we developed a sense of identification with nations is, of course, because of media, because of print newspaper and so on. So we see ourselves as Americans and British. And it's something that was constructed through the construction of the modern state and through the construction of newspapers. Well, we're in the process of constructing something completely new with internet, with links. You know, nowadays, the people that you care about are the people that you know, but they may not just be your neighbors. They may be people you meet at school who come from all over the world. They may be people from the community where you came from. And so all sorts of new loyalties are being developed. So that's my second point. And my third point is that actually America's very far behind on all this. I mean, if you know, in the European Union, a lot of these ideas have been accepted. I'm not saying the European Union's very good at doing things, but it is better at it, although on a much more limited scale. And, you know, I just spoke last week to the Belgian High Command. They've accepted a human security doctrine. And if you think about what's happened over the last 20 years, the development of UN peacekeeping and all of these things, we have got better at it. I don't say we can do it, but I really think we've got better at it. And if we don't sort of, well, you yourself are somebody who pushes something quite utopian, and if there weren't voices arguing for that, then, you know, the world would go backwards, I think. So those are all my reasons. And then when I come, my points here, I'm not sure you have got our assumptions right, actually. First of all, I don't think we say that civilians can be separated. I don't think we think in terms of civilians are winnable, because we assume that an intervention of the kind we're talking about would only take place when people were desperate and wanted an intervention. So it's not thinking in those terms. I don't think we necessarily assume that citizens are capable of overcoming internal divisions, because, but I think what we do think is that very often the guys with the guns are the guys promoting division. And the reason they take the guns is that society is not divided. That's my view. In my view, many of these ethnic sectarian conflicts are constructed. People in Bosnia didn't hate each other before the war began. Shias and Sunnis didn't hate each other in Baghdad before they started killing each other. So if you create a stable space, it doesn't mean that you will overcome internal division, but at least once people feel secure, they can talk to each other and attitudes may change. And, and the idea that, are we capable? I'm not sure whether we're capable. We're just suggesting ways in which we might be capable. I don't think we're capable yet. And finally, on international humanitarian law, I really don't think it's quite the same thing. Because international humanitarian law starts on the assumption of two collectivities fighting each other. And that's the big difference with the human security approach. We are concerned both about the vulnerability of individuals as opposed to collectivities, and about the responsibility of individuals as opposed to the responsibility of states. In other words, the guys who inflict this kind of violence are individual criminals rather than collectivities and that's a huge difference. I mean, we could go into detail about it, but I think that's a very big difference.
Just a couple of things, Thanks to both of you for your remarks. You used the example of Rwanda. And when I talk about human security, when I talk about the failures of the international community, the failures of the legal system, one of the examples I use is Rwanda, where 800,000 people were killed in a period of 100 days. The second example that I use that's ongoing right now is what's going on in Eastern Congo. We don't know how many millions of people have been killed, not through direct violence, but through lack of services, through lack of providing for health care and those kinds of things. But one of the things that we often see is we use examples from the past in laws and regulations and rules of the past, and then somehow impose a human security paradigm on it to somehow show that this failed. The point that we're trying to make is getting the language right from the beginning in order that it won't fail, getting the language right from the outset that allows us that ability and the freedom of action in those types of situations. Because having spent time in Rwanda, it is very embarrassing to be an American. And knowing that we actually, when I was in Germany, we were preparing for some type of intervention, and it never happened. And we were seeing, one of my friends was on the ground there, and we were listening to these reports. We were hearing this, and it was extremely disturbing. And when I had the opportunity to finally get in and see that, I know that we failed. And that was a lot of the motivation of writing this book, is so those kinds of things don't happen again. I think that's very important. As Mary mentioned, you know, the idea that the book is utopian, yes. I mean, Jeffersonian democracy in itself is utopian, and I mean, we can only achieve those things that we have the language to go towards. But this isn't just a pie in the sky type of activity. I very much disagree that there is a separation of humanitarian space and conflict space. I would challenge that through looking at the examples where I've been in parts of Kenya, where in Somalia, in Darfur, in southern Sudan, in Eastern Congo, in the Niger Delta, there is really no humanitarian space, even though it would be terrific if we could separate out as you mentioned, the combatants from the non-combatants. But that's no longer the case. The bad guys aren't wearing black uniforms, and the good guys aren't wearing white uniforms. It's very much blended together. So if we don't have that language that, again, as Mary discussed, and the rule of law, then we are going to be seen as combatants, and the killings that happen in the name of trying to sort out the good guys from the bad guys, that's still killing of innocent civilians. That's still a more of an implosion of humanitarian space, which makes it more difficult for our NGO community, more difficult for our aid workers. Whereas if we had the rule of law and we had more of a human security paradigm as a policing type of action, then we're not seen as combatants, aggressors, and those that are coming to kill, but those that are trying to police and protect. And I think that's sort of the distinction that we have to make, that if we take 20th century language, there is very much concern of separating out the humanitarian space from the combatant space. But the reality on the ground is something far different, as we see across Africa and even in Afghanistan and Iraq and those places.
Can I add just one little point? Because I do think that Human Rights Watch should retain its independence, but not just from the military, from all officialdom, because how else can you monitor what's happening on the ground? So in that sense, but I don't think that's the same necessarily as preserving humanitarian space. That's about, you know, being about civil society and being independent.
Yeah, it's just the broader idea that humanitarian and human rights actors need to distinguish themselves from combatants, from the military.
I completely agree with that. And I think you only don't distinguish if the military change and become human security officers. I think if you don't, as long as that's exactly why human security is so important, right. As long as you're just talking about male civ. Well, obviously, civilians are going to be targets if they identify with combatants. So unless the military shift, the civilians can't either. But the answer isn't to preserve humanitarian space, because, well, I agree with Shannon on this. I just think it's disappearing.
So why don't we open it up to all of you? Any reactions, questions? Yes.
Yeah, I don't agree that. I mean, I think there's lots of good things in international humanitarian law, so I wouldn't want to throw it out. But I don't agree that I think international humanitarian law was based on a very traditional idea of conflict, a traditional idea of war between states, and the parties to international humanitarian law are states' parties. And the idea of military necessity, I find quite problematic. So for all those reasons, I do think that, but at the same time, there's such a confusion in these new operations between international humanitarian law, human rights law, domestic rules of engagement, domestic law, the law of the sending countries, that I'm not saying that we need an entirely new legal framework. What I'm saying is we need to find ways to bring these bodies of law together and to work out how you manage conflicts in these different bodies of law and how they would be resolved and what new elements are required.
I think the only thing I would add to that is, again, my experience being in Africa and seeing things on the ground. The struggle to find some type of legal framework that allows for that intervention. And that legal framework either not being there or being so weak that it does not send the clear signals to those that could potentially intervene to protect lives, and as a result of that, the lives go spent. I'm thinking about Darfur, and what is the legal framework that gives us very distinctive capabilities and very distinctive context to be able to go in and to separate out combatants from the non-combatants, if you want to call it that. But I, having been on the ground there, it's just a lot of conflict that is very difficult to discern the combatants from non-combatants. And so how is it that we can have that legal framework the same way in Eastern Congo? The things that are going on there, it's not combatants from a state. They are rebel groups, they are paramilitary groups, they are police forces. There is a number of non-traditional actors. And one of the other things that Mary and I really didn't discuss very much is talking about this security gap being filled by private security contractors. These things, we've seen that in Iraq and Afghanistan. There is no real legal context to have these groups in this fight or in this 21st century security architecture, and they are there and they will continue to be there. So how is it that we incorporate that and have some type of structure that we can move forward with?
Can I just react to the one, the last point that I think you made implicitly, which is regarding whether this is a good moment, even if there's a need for improvement or refinement of the legal architecture, would this be a good moment to try? I think, you know, the answer is no. And if you look at the past decade, the governments that have made noises about the need to change international humanitarian law have been governments that very clearly want to erode the existing protections. And lately it's been the Israeli government. I'm sure Eyal is following it much closer than I have. But the Bush administration, particularly in the first years after September 11th, was criticizing, you know, when it wasn't saying that those, mostly it was saying that those laws didn't apply and the Geneva Conventions were irrelevant. But it was also saying that there was a need for adapting legal structures to fit this new kind of war. And they certainly weren't talking about increasing protections for the civilian population.
Also, one word about the possibility of making changes now in the law. The picture is not all bleak, because we do see civil society reacting to, for example, recently to the cluster bomb, the new cluster bomb, a new treaty banning cluster bomb. This is a product of civil society reacting to the use of cluster bomb in 2006 by Israel in Lebanon. So you do see that the field is not overtaken by government. You do see reaction and quite successful reaction by civil society. But then you need to have very focused goals, very specific goals like anti-personnel mines or specific types of weapons. And here we talk about something that is very open-ended, more abstract, right? And it's, I think it's difficult to find common ground and very with specific goals that can be addressed in a particular treaty. And I don't think that you mean anything of that sort. But I would suggest that there are different readings of IHL. There is the way that, you know, modern strong powers interpret the law, and there are ways in which the civil society and ICRC and others interpret the law. The traditional understanding of the law in the 19th century and the motivation for adopting rules concerning occupation in the 19th century are I would submit the same motivation of those now, including in this table, that seek a more humane or human rights-based approach, which is try to separate as much as you can the population and treat it well, because And here's the, there's a point here, and maybe I can ask a question. 19th century, the explanation was it's self-interest. It is a self-interest of the occupier to treat the population well so that there was no animosity and no opposition to it. Now, in your book, and you also made this point in your talk, you said that you say that there's a huge difference between your approach and the, for example, the counterinsurgency approach. And the difference is that in counterinsurgency, the treatment of the population is a means to the goal. And in your case, this is the goal, to treat the population humanely. Could you just spell out or explain what difference does it make? What difference the attitude of the intervener in this context, how does this make a difference? What are the mechanism of this change that your attitude provides, whereas the counterinsurgency attitude does not?
Well, I did say that, which was, I mean, I think it's partly why we're there. What's the goal? So I think that matters. I think what you say matters. And it matters to the population, what you say. But it's not just enough to say it. You have to take it seriously. And I do think it affects the rules of engagement. And I've talked to a lot of soldiers about this. I mean, I think the rules of engagement are much tighter than they are in a classic, if the rules of engagement are the same as you would operate in a domestic situation, rather than those that you would operate in armed conflict, they are just much tighter. There's another point, of course, which is also very important, which is if you see your goal as human security, you take more seriously what we call in the book, and I didn't talk about it, the bottom-up approach, that in the end, it's terribly important to understand people, to communicate with people, to respect people. And that doesn't really happen. There's a tendency to think the way to end a conflict is to talk to the guys with the guns or the political leadership and not to talk to ordinary people. And so it also makes a difference to how you behave. And that's very important too.
And if I could add to that, I think how you handle the populations determines whether you're looking for a tactical end state or a strategic end state. Because within counterinsurgency, you're looking at, again, focusing on killing the enemy to win. And the population very much is a means to an end of doing that. That gives you a tactical type of end, which means that the populations aren't considered, their security isn't considered. And so once we pull out, there is going to be a vacuum there for now who provides for that security. And it's going to be filled probably by the Taliban, probably by a more nefarious force. Whereas if we are looking at a human security paradigm with a strategic end state of a sustainable security based on the population that they can maintain it for themselves, then I think that's the very dramatic difference between a counterinsurgency approach and a human security approach.
Yes.
First, just a comment on responsibility to protect. I mean, I think it was a great step forward, but I'm still not completely happy with it as a concept. And I'm not happy because I'm not actually happy with the shift from rights to responsibility. I mean, I think it's much better to have a right to be protected than, because the responsibility to protect is still about the outside powers having a responsibility when, rather than the local people having a right to be protected. It may result in the same end state, but I think it's a real problem because it focuses the debate on when can outsiders intervene rather than the debate on when do people need support. That's just a minor, I mean, it's not a big point. It's a conceptual point and it doesn't. But I think in terms of how the UN is, I mean, I think it's very interesting that the UN has had an enormous growth in peacekeeping capacities, and the last two decades have been an enormous learning process. And there's been a big focus on how to do protection, on building up civilian capacities and all of this kind of thing. So there's a learning process going on, which is actually reflected in the numbers. You know, there has been a decline in the number of conflicts, ongoing conflicts in the world, and there has been a decline in the number of people killed in conflicts. That, and I think that a lot of that can be attributed to the action of the UN, the EU, and various outside groups. Not all of it, of course. But at the same time, there are still some terrible conflicts going on. There's still terrible human rights violations going on. So one shouldn't... But I do think there's been progress. And I think it's interesting. We just did a session at Columbia with Jean-Marie Guernot, who used to be in charge of peacekeeping, and he was saying his concern with the current UN protection preoccupation with protection is that it doesn't really take politics into account. You know, and it's very difficult if both the Congo and Afghanistan are very similar in that respect, which is that, and that would be where a human security approach would differ, is that human beings there are suffering not just from an insurgency, they're suffering from a very predatory, abusive government. And the UN and the outside forces are operating in support of those predatory, abusive governments. So until you do something about the nature of those governments, it's very difficult. So if you just focus on, as it were, the tactical aspects of protection without thinking about the broader political and contextual factors, then that's quite problematic. And I think that is true of a lot of what the UN does. Well, it might be naive. I mean, I think... Well, I think if you don't start with security, and this is what has happened in many places, it's happening in Afghanistan, it happened in Bosnia, humanitarian aid simply fuels the conflict. It goes into the pockets of the warlords and the drug barons. It goes into, in Bosnia, it was a major source of finance for the various militias. So yeah, that's a big problem with humanitarian aid if it isn't in the context of an overall security approach. The other question which you're really asking is, there is an assumption that we make that if you provide security, if there's in a society where there's rule of law and order, most people have a vested interest in maintaining law and order and in not rocking the boat, as it were. You know, that in a sense, in a situation of law and order, you can isolate the guys who disagree. And That is an assumption in the book. I think, you know, that many contemporary conflicts are the result of a very weak law and order, very weak states, in which conflict entrepreneurs, whether they're criminal guys or extremist politicians, can somehow make use of it. And the more that they create violence, the more they benefit, and the more people do start to hate each other, or to at least depend on one or other of the conflict entrepreneurs for protection. And so you create a situation in which it's very difficult to make peace. Now, of course, you're right. If you created a secure situation and then tried, and my assumption is those guys are marginal guys. They would never be where they were if it were not for violence. And that if you created a secure situation where people could have a debate, you would come up with a more sensible outcome. That's my assumption. That is true. But I think that is a correct assumption. But, you know, it's one you can challenge, in which case I would be very depressed about what can be done, because violence isn't going to work. Nothing else will work. So there's a hope that at least in that situation, you're more likely to find a better outcome.
And if I could just add to that, one of the things we discuss in the book along those lines is we call it creating a vortex of violence, that the longer that these go on without some type of guarantees of security, the larger these problems become, and the greater these problems become, and the more inextractable that they become. And I mean, the example that I think of every time is what to do about Somalia. You know, I mean, it's just that started out as something that really, I mean, if you think about why the United States went into Somalia, it was very much for a human securities type of mission, food security. We didn't see it that way, and so what we immediately did was we divided guys into good guys and bad guys, and we made the bad guys really bad and the good guys really weren't that good, and what did it get us? But we see this vortex of violence just continuing on to where, what do you call Somalia today? And again, because there are no guarantees of security, and we can do whatever we want right now with humanitarian aid and those kinds of things, but it really is fueling more of the conflict than it is anything else. So that's the root of the question is, how do you break that cycle of violence and guarantee some type of security? Because, again, when people are living in very desperate situations, they are more than willing to mortgage their futures for survival today. And that makes those tomorrows that much more desperate. And, again, that cycle continues to spread out.
Yeah, I think there was another question. Did you have a question?
Well, that's absolutely central to our book. I mentioned a very key thing in our book is the bottom-up approach. Actually, in the end, in any situation, it's the local people, the people on the ground, who have to make peace. You know, and I think one of the first things outsiders have to learn is a bit of modesty. You know, they have to understand that what they can do to help is very, very limited. The most they can do is to help create some security and obviously provide material support when it's needed. But in the end, if local people are not able, in the end, it is the people on the ground who find a solution. And the most that outsiders can do is to make that possible. They can't do it for them. And so interacting locally. I mean, I think one of the good things about Petraeus was his injunction, live amongst the people. I think if I think about the surge in Iraq and what worked, it was the fact that American soldiers were put in joint security stations inside Baghdad with Iraqi soldiers. And that meant you saw people in an everyday. And that's actually how you get kind of human sympathy. I mean, I think I talked to a lot of British soldiers who were in Bosnia who just felt that it was terrible that they had to stand by. They felt that the people they met as they went along weren't so different from British people. As soon as you know someone, then, as one officer said to me, everyone has a humanitarian conscience in the end. But it's very different having a humanitarian conscience about somebody you've met, whether it's your neighbor or whether it's someone you met in Bosnia, than it is having a humanitarian conscience about an abstract person. So interacting with local population, and one of my very strong arguments is it's terribly important to involve women without being kind of essentialist about women's roles. I do think in general you will find women are kind of outside the conflict. Their major concerns are with how to get survival for their families, and so actually involving women and getting them to think about these issues is terribly, terribly important. Very often they do. I mean, one of the things that I've found in the many conflict areas I've visited, there's always a women's movement that's trying to cross boundaries that is never reported outside.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Can I take first stab at that? I think what's really important here is that, and I couldn't agree more, that how do you get Main Street Peoria in Illinois to believe that what's going on in Somalia, what's going on in the Central African Republic actually means something to, you know, to Main Street? And again, that's the reason that I use the example of, you know, the power of technology, the cell phone communications, being able to link in. A real-world example. We used to discuss security in terms of international security and domestic security. There was the far side and the near side, and you know, we in the United States enjoyed quite a bit of human security, and we had domestic laws, and international was something different. But what we've seen is a withering away of that from the international and domestic to what I've called intermestic type of security. The example I use is Somalia. One of the largest ongoing FBI investigations in the United States is happening right now in Minneapolis, Minnesota, with our Somali population, or the Somali population there, that has been identified and seen as recruiting for Al-Qaeda, for raising funds for Al-Qaeda, and also these populations are going to Somalia to train in combatant operations and returning to the United States. Now, I mean, if you've ever been to Minneapolis, Minnesota, I mean, it doesn't get more white bread than that. I mean, that's pretty much cookie cutter kind of place. The point being is that there is no division anymore. I mean, this can happen anywhere at any time. So to be able to make it, and it's going to be a lot of heavy lifting, because the American population, we tend to be lazy. We tend not to want to see you cross the pond. We tend not to want to see these things until it's too late. We're very reactionary. But by the same token, the time that it takes for us to react is shortened so much now. And where these threats are coming from is coming from such various sources that dialogue and that discourse has to change. Because, you know, we don't know where that next threat is going to come from, but we do know that it can reach out and touch us very quickly from unknown sources, from unknown places. So if we don't accept that, as we have to be engaged proactively before these things happen, before these areas break, then it's going to come back and haunt us. And I think Mary can talk more about the 7/7 bombings and why that actually happened. I mean, there are real-world scenarios and cases that very much point to our requirement to engage proactively before things break, rather than waiting until after they break and waiting for the response to those situations.
Yes.
Well, a couple of things. First off, the idea of being drawn to a cause, that isn't new. But the response time and the ability to react and also the information that you can gather, that has been, that timeline has been compressed exponentially. So that is a little bit different. The idea of being drawn to the cause certainly is that that's gone on for centuries. As far as the resource issue, again, there are a lot of resources out there. There are a lot of multiplicitous efforts going on that because it's not coordinated, it's because we're not opening this aperture to non-traditional security actors. One organization is doing one thing, and then, for example, I mean, I use the military example. Lots of efforts that we are completely unaware of. We are doing the exact same thing with different monies. And a lot of those resources are being wasted rather than having a model of efficiency. And so I think one of the first things to do is look and open the aperture and say, okay, who is doing what on the ground? Let's get an accurate assessment. Let's talk to the various actors that are on the ground to get an idea of exactly what is going on before we decide to, you know, hop on the truck with the good idea ferry. And I think that's important.
Yes.
Just to add to that, so I think that's true of other applications, not just
I'd just like to, oh, well, you answer that.
Well, I mean, very quickly, I couldn't agree more. And again, that's the reason I said what I did is that, you know, until we have the words, until we have the language that can achieve these outcomes, it's going to continue to be this siloed type of approach because it is a humanitarian community that's very concerned about working with the military. It's a military that sort of looks with a raised eyebrow of, okay, how good can these civilian institutions be? All of those kinds of things. So there's a lot of suspicion all the way around, and there's a lot of protecting of Fabergé rice bowls as well. You know, so, I mean, we have to get away from that because there are very limited resources, and those need to be husbanded very, very economically, very efficiently to get to a longer-term sustainable type of outcome. And so couldn't agree more.
I just wanted to say a couple of things on the sort of round of questions we've just had. One was about resources. I mean, I think we point this out in the book that the UN peacekeeping budget is 0.5% of the US defense budget. And, you know, one of the problems with the U.S. defense budget has been that so much money is spent on these unbelievably expensive, sophisticated weapon systems that there's been a fantastic reduction in numbers of men. That's why the U.S. effort is so dependent on private contractors who earn huge salaries. They leave the military, so there's a huge incentive for them to leave. So that further reduces the scale of the military because they all can make so much more money as private security contractors. And the US Army is more and more dependent on, in a way, the dropouts of American society. And I think that's a huge resource problem. And I think if you were to do human security, you would need, actually, you wouldn't need an overall increase in resources, but you'd need a massive transfer of resources from these kinds of very sophisticated weapon systems to things that were much more people-based. I mean, I think there are some new technologies, particularly communications technologies, which would be very important in human security operations. But I think you do need an expansion of people and a reduction in these very sophisticated weapon systems that aren't used. Another comment I'd like to make is, and I hope I don't sound too Eurocentric saying this, but I think there's a much greater sort of human rights and humanitarian sensibility among European countries than there is here in the United States. And a lot of what people are saying comes from an American perspective, and that was very much my motivation for writing the book. I mean, looking at all kinds of EU operations, looking at the doctrines of individual European states, which are moving very dramatically in this direction that I'm talking about. They're constantly pulled back by their membership in NATO, by their relationship with the US. And it has moved to quite a degree. I mean, people do sort of raise public concerns about issues that we're talking about. So I just do think there's a different way of thinking about these things. And one shouldn't, you know, treat how people think about it in the United States as the universal way in which people think about it.
I just wanted to jump in because it seems to me that the focus on being proactive is one of the rather utopian dimensions in the argument, in that it doesn't seem to me to reflect the way in which public policy is made in most, for want of a better word, advanced democracies, which from my experience, you know, both when I, you know, was in public service, but you know, I've been involved in a number of aspects of public policy making since as an advisor or consultant, that it's profoundly reactive, and it's you know, reactive on a very, very short time frame, both in terms of, you know, the events that trigger policy action, as well as the time horizon of politicians in terms of when they need to get results, because that's obviously tied to re-election. And so, I mean, it seems to me that one needs to address this in some sense head on, and it's beautifully illustrated by, I think, Joanne's example about that meeting in the White House. And, you know, the connection between international and local security seems to be so weak in, you know, in the policy culture in the U.S. that, you know, I've looked at the situation in Mexico develop in alarming ways, and there you're not talking about a place that's, you know, 10,000 miles away. It's on the U.S. border, and the relationship with immediate interest, and in fact, some of the security problems are most intense in areas very close to the U.S. border, and yet the reaction has not yet, you know, come, and you know, it surprises me. Maybe you would say that in Europe, something like that going on, let's say, you know, so that close to the border of, you know, of Germany would you know, result in a faster trigger. But when you look at what happened with the breakup of Yugoslavia, there was almost no proactivity, you know, there. And you know, people like myself who had, you know, who had worked in the, you know, in the former Yugoslavia, knew something about the situation there. You know, we're kind of, you know, voices in the wilderness, and a lot could have been done. But I guess I'm just rephrasing the concern that the pathology is built not into only the lack of vision about the means by which one should intervene and the strategies, but also by the way in which the policy process, actually works. And that isn't about the values; it's about the structure and pathologies of democratic government.
Well, actually, I agree with that. I mean, I think, you know, there's so many examples, and the breakup of Yugoslavia was a very good example when nobody had a clue what to do. And they were going through a learning process all the time, and they were always behind the curve. And you know, in Europe, there's an enormous amount of talk about having better early warning. But actually, early warning doesn't help. I mean, Kosovo was a conflict that was waiting to happen from 1991 onwards, and nobody really took it seriously as an issue of conflict prevention. So in that sense, I agree with you, but I do think there are certain things one could shift, and I think in order to be able to be more proactive. And one of them is just that this imbalance between military and civilians. I mean, we've seen over the last two decades an incredible reduction in the diplomatic services of all countries and big cuts. And actually, it's the presence of civilians. And also we need a different kind of diplomacy. Instead of the sort of classic state to state, we need diplomacy that really gets outside of states and talks to ordinary people. And I think that is very much part of a human security approach. So in a way, it does require a shift in the policy process, and even more ambitiously, something that we've talked about is that I think nowadays, you know, you do need access for citizens. You know, you need to change the democratic process so that it's not simply always confined by the nation state, because that's also a reason that you can't get that. People don't have access in Kosovo to politicians in Washington or whatever it is. I think there are a few moves. I mean, one of the things I'm quite excited about, I sound like a total European, but I don't mean to be, because I have lots of criticisms of the European Union, but the new External Action Service, which is going to be a kind of new diplomatic arm, which will focus on crisis management, is a very good step in that direction.
You know, and I would just say that I think that in the book there is a totally persuasive and useful toolkit for dealing with a whole range of situations. So even if one were not to buy into the paradigm shift, there are a lot of, you know, extremely valuable lessons distilled from experience that could make, you know, an incremental difference in many situations, including ones that are, you know, that are obviously have already been screwed up to a great extent, so that one wouldn't, you know, want to create the expectation that one could, you know, kind of unscrew them up very quickly, but that one could make a lot of important incremental differences. And so maybe along those lines, you could say something about, you know, your suggestions for where we would go now in Afghanistan, for example. I mean, given that the situation, given all the mistakes that have, you know, that have been made.
Well, I think the first thing to say is that, you know, if I was proposing something from Afghanistan, I wouldn't start from here. But we are where we are. And
that's what I mean.
Exactly.
Yeah, given that we are where we are.
Yeah. We are where we are. And I'm actually not in favor of rapid withdrawal, because I think that would leave Afghanistan open to a very nasty combination of warlords and the Taliban. and we would leave Afghanistan in a worse state than we found it. And having intervened in 2001, whatever you think of it, I mean, I was actually not in favor of the intervention. I think we have a responsibility to do something about it. So what does doing something about it mean? Well, first of all, it means a different narrative. It means us saying very clearly, we're in Afghanistan to create stability and security for Afghans. That doesn't mean we completely lose the narrative, we're in Afghanistan to make our streets safer. But actually, neither what we're doing at the moment nor withdrawal will make our streets safer. What we're doing at the moment is actually, I think, recruiting more people to the Al-Qaeda cause. Withdrawal will create a sort of Al-Qaeda safe haven. So actually, it will, in the end, maybe help, but the primary reason we're there is the security of Afghanistan. And I just think saying that and start that, using that as a starting point. But then a whole lot of things follow from that, and I could go through all our principles, which I do in the introduction, or we do, to show what follows from that. But I think very key in what follows from that is, first of all, the reduction in collateral damage. There has been a big reduction over the last year. There's been a great deal of restraint over airstrikes, but nevertheless, civilians are still being killed in night raids, which are completely, I mean, unacceptable in any country that you rush into a person's house in the middle of the night, but even really bad in Afghanistan, where home is sacrosanct. And civilians do get killed, and it really alienates local people. But also, key is the predatory and abusive behavior of the government. I think that's the biggest problem at the moment in Afghanistan, that the contractors, private security contractors of the US, are very often into the drug trade, using money. And a huge amount of US aid has gone to build big houses in Dubai for warlords. And these warlords behave in very, violate human rights, behave in very repressive ways. So I think something very crucial has to be done about the political situation. And my proposal actually would be that there should be pressure on Karzai, really serious pressure, to just arrest the 50 top criminals.
And have including his brother.
Including his brother. His brother? Somebody, including his brother, absolutely. Actually, I was thinking, couldn't the U.S. And the offer by the U.S. forces to arrest them. In the case of his brother, he actually has American citizenship. And given that he has been abusing the aid he's received from the United States, there's absolutely no reason why US forces shouldn't go and arrest him without the permission of Karzai. And some of these criminals are American citizens, so they could be arrested. But I think the better way would be to have them arrested by Karzai with the support of the American forces. So that's the second thing I would do. I would enormously involve civil society in a political process. And I'm not just talking about improving elections, because elections are very problematic, but more having much greater access, having much greater debate about how they solve the problems and taking that much more seriously. That would be a huge difference that needs to be undertaken. I would put much more effort into the regional ties. Of course, Pakistan is being taken very seriously now, although I don't want to go into what's wrong with the Pakistan policy, particularly the drone attacks. But I think I'd also, Iran is very important, Uzbekistan is very important. And then a final thing which I think is key is that the problem with the operation in Afghanistan is that it is too militarized. And I understand why that's happened, because the civilian political leadership has been very weak. And the military, at the moment, the military leadership are the only people who really understand the situation. And actually, I thought McChrystal's report was great. The problem is that it's very difficult to implement, both because ordinary American soldiers don't get it and because the civilian leadership doesn't get it. And what, you know, it should have been the Holbrooke report. because it should have been coming from the civilian leadership, and it should be a much more civilian operation. So those are all the kind of changes I would propose.
So we have about 2 to 3 minutes left, and I'm just going to ask if anyone else on the panel just wants to make a quick 1 minute response on any of the issues that have been raised. Why don't we go from left to right? Eyal?
I think I have nothing to add, and I think the issues have come up.
Joanne?
I guess I would just say I learned a nice term tonight, conflict entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
I think the challenge, one of the challenges your book raises at least, is how to create prevention entrepreneurs. And you pointed that out. And I think that's a very interesting point your book makes.
Shannon?
I think that the point that I would end with was the exact same point that I started with, that until the language changes, we're going to continue to talk around each other, across each other, through each other. And that language also requires that the metrics for security change to be able to identify situations such as Rwanda so they never happen again. And that's important, and I think that this audience will have a lot to do with that. And thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very stimulating session and for coming by. Thanks.
Thank you for organizing.